morning. Memorial Day. Pentecost. A lot to observe, a lot to celebrate. Let's stand and sing our praise to God.
Wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. Father, I ask that you be with the families who mourn their fallen soldiers and military members. Lord, I ask that you be with everyone here today and pour your spirit into our service. We ask all these things in your name. Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. I'll tell you what, I don't know if you have this slide up there, but if you ever served our military, would you please stand?
Driving the other?
He will be driving the other.
Okay. GPS. I have a box in the back of my truck for y'all too.
Okay, so we have plenty of cardboard boxes. But we will take yours.
This is the big one.
Okay, yes, we need the big one. I already was playing on so. Okay, I do still need some of the empty 12-pack Coke boxes because those are going for a specific game. We've got some, but I can use a few more of those. And we've gotten some poster board, but everything else up there we still need. So beach balls, the blank canvases, I would say the 12 to 18 inch mainly because we're going to use them for a specific purpose on that. Frisbees, spray paint, plastic tablecloths.
Board games.
We have a few board games, but I'd love to have more of those, just your classic, board games. That is the theme this year, while I'm talking about it. Okay, so it's a board game theme, and our tagline is Following Jesus Changes the Game. So in June, we're going to be doing a change drive. The kids are going to have a goal to fill the bucket, so start the next Sunday, bring your pocket change. They'll get prizes based on how much they raise. And that'll go towards our BBS.
We also need some large toys that match the pieces of a Monopoly board. So like a large car. When I say large, I mean like this. Not like what's in the
just not your tiny Monopoly pieces.
Yeah, and so
like a large boot. If you have we're gonna spray paint on silver like the Monopoly pieces, but we want a bigger version.
Yeah. So if you have a dog that maybe
not a room.
Like a dog that sits against the door. You know, back in the day when we let hens blow through, they had these door stops. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Well, thank God. And so if you have one of those that you'd like to get rid of, I'll paint it and we'll save it for an operator. If it's a dog. Not if it's something else, I don't know. You got something else? Oh, well, why don't you do that? Because we're going to need workers.
Yes. If y'all want to save the date, it's July 16th through the 20th.
What time?
6 to 8. Volunteers, 5:30 meal, and then you also have opportunity as you're rotating around if you don't have that to have the meal with the kids.
Okay. So, 16th through the
20th of July.
20th. All right. Anything else? Camp volunteers. I still would take any volunteers. Ms. Connie, if you want to go, I would love to have you go to camp with us. Not to mean to call you out, but just would love to have you. I've called a few people individually and have begged you, and I'm not beyond begging. If you would like for me to call you and beg you to come to camp, I would love to have you. Your age has no limit on that. If you're able to walk around with kids, you're able to go. So we would love to have you, and there's a little bit of administration we need to take care of for that. So if you'd be willing to go, please let Kayla know, or Melanie or myself. Justin and Brian helped me move Melanie back yesterday. So she is down to like one little bookcase and a couple of odds and ends, and I mean, she has two more days to spend over there, and I will be a happy man again. Another great thing that happened is I'm no longer the long-term sub, which is even better. I don't know if it's better. But it is better. I am much elated not to be there anymore. It really made me question my ministry. It led me to really, I second guess whether I was supposed to be in ministry because of that long-term sub project. So I am thankful to be through with that. And I pray God took whatever effort I gave to it and blessed it. But it was a tough one. So thank God to be out of that. Anything else that we need to bring before the church this morning? All right.
Thank you. Dear Lord, as we come to you this morning as a community of believers, we'd ask for peace and comfort for those who are dealing with uncertainty in their health, Lord, dealing with the loss of loved ones, and Lord, also for the joyous celebration of couples getting married and starting families together. And Lord, we're thankful for the opportunities that you provide for us during the week to witness, to mentor, to hold one another accountable. And we're thankful for the saints that you've placed in our lives to give us a good example. And Lord, we're thankful for Melanie's finally going to get to come home and be the helpmate that David has yearned for longer than a year. And Lord, we're thankful for his ministry here in New Boston. And we just pray that you'll continue to be with him and continue to offer him the support and encouragement that he needs. And Lord, we're thankful for the veterans that have sacrificed their lives so that we may live in a country where we're free to assemble in a church on Sunday morning and give you the worship and praise that you so rightly deserve. And Lord, forgive us when we fall short of making you a priority in our lives. Forgive us where we fail one another. But Lord, we'd ask that you send your Holy Spirit into our midst this morning, that we may be better encouragers and better ambassadors for you. And we'll ask all these things in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, with the prayer that he taught his disciples so long ago. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
so you all know what Memorial Day is about? What is it? Yes. Yes. And veterans. Right? We use it for sure to remember the veterans. But we can remember others at this time too, right? So, but what makes a veteran? You got Army Green Nails. I just love that. What makes a veteran?
A veteran is a person who has fought and served for the war and the wars.
Okay. Yes. Someone who goes to war for our country and gets out of the military or passes away or whatever, any of those that have served in our military makes them a veteran. And do you know what a veteran's job is?
What?
A veteran's job. You know? To serve what? And what does that mean to serve for our country? To protect our country. What are we protecting? Okay, we're protecting our freedom, and we're protecting our borders, right? And sometimes we even go and protect other people who are unable to protect themselves. And that's where a lot of our wars come from, is when we're trying to protect others. And sometimes those wars are necessary, and sometimes they're not. But whether they are necessary or not, a veteran goes wherever his country sends him or her to be a part of a group that protects our freedoms and protects the rights of others. And So today, we're going to remember those, not only the ones that we remember on Veterans Day who are alive, but also those who have passed on who tried to fight for our freedoms, you know? And even those that maybe just died of old age. You know, I knew, you know that picture of the flag with the soldiers underneath it and they're pushing the flag up? You ever seen that picture? It's at Iwo Jima. Well, if you ever get a chance to see that picture, I knew a colonel that was in with those guys pushing that flag up, and I had him come and speak to our church one time. He passed on since then. But he said that those guys were all, not just the ones you see, but there were people underneath them helping push them up to push that flag up. So there was a lot more soldiers than what we see with that picture, pushing that flag up, pushing those soldiers up so they could push the flag up. And so it just reminds us of how precious it is to have rights in our world, and to have the right to be free, and to have the right to worship God, and to the right to raise our families to worship God, and all those wonderful things we get to see with the freedom that we remember today that people died for. Okay? So, I want you to understand what Memorial Day is. It is to remember our veterans and those that serve our country in whatever way that presents itself. Okay? So, I want you to go have a good lesson today, and but let's hold on a minute and pray. Did any of you want to pray? No, me neither. I don't. Me neither. All right, so let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for our kids, and we lift them up to you, and we thank you so much for their parents and for all their teachers. And we just ask that this summer, the teachers and the parents that take care of these kids will get all the rest that they need in Christ's name. Father God, we ask that you would take our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings and use them to further your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. In Christ's name, amen. I believe we raised like $1,300, was that right, last week for the Gideons? So, just so you know, we raised $1,300 for the Gideons in the Bible ministry. Thank you.
Our scripture reading today is Psalms 37, verse 7. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes. This is the word of the Lord for the people of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Whether I'm looking for him or not, Sometimes
We get so caught up in ourselves and what's going on with ourselves that our ministry is no good. Sometimes we are so earthly minded, we're no heavenly good. And sometimes you're so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. So that works both ways. We need a good balance of keeping heavenly mindedness and earthly mindedness, right? We need to be able to take heavenly things and bring them to earth and take earthly things before the Lord and give them to Him, right? What did Jesus say? Store up your treasures in heaven. Ah. What are our earthly treasures that we store up in heaven? Exactly right. That is the greatest treasure you can obtain on this earth, is for someone to come to know the Lord. When I was called to ministry, I was running like Jonah in the whales. I don't know if y'all seen that. Yep, there's a new album out called Jonah and the Whales. Wasn't this funny, huh? All right. Anyway, I was like him, and the army took me in. I was on a ship, you know. I was on the ship to Tarshish. I was on a ship in the army to run from God. Right? I was gonna make a lot of money. That was what the recruiter told me. Funny how some of the guys that were signing up with me got bonuses and I didn't. Sign-on bonus. Not my MOS. You know, not my job. So I was running to the Army. I was working three jobs. I would get up at 8 o'clock. I had to be at work at 9. And I would work White's Cafeteria from 9 until 5. And I became assistant manager there. So I was 17, 18 years old, and I'm working as an assistant manager from 9 to 5. At 5, I would run down and wait tables at El Chico's. And so from 5 to 10, I waited tables at El Chico's. And then, because I liked to work back in those days, not so much now, but back in those days, I would work from 10 to 2 at Texas Star Cafe in Longview. You might remember where it was over there across from Albertson's on the loop. But I would wash their glasses, their bar glasses. And all the recruiters were right next to Texas Star Cafe. So when they got off work, they would come into Texas Star Cafe, and I'd be there washing their glasses. And they started talking to this young man who was working so many jobs because they wanted somebody like him in the military. And I said, well, I tell you what, tell me about it. And they said, well, you can make what you're making now with these three jobs by joining the Army and just working one. You're going to make some money. Boy, did they lie to me. Okay. And then I said, all right, I tell you what, my uncles were in the military, my dads were in the military. I want to know the truth. Don't hold nothing back, because I don't want to get there and find out different. Right? So tell me how hard it is. Tell me what they're going to say at boot camp, all these kind of things. So, I mean, I'm getting the rundown, you know, and they're like, well, hey, they're going to be on you. They're going to do this. They're going to do that. And pretty much they were right, you know. I only got mad once in the Army, and that was when they talked about my mom. And that was a normal thing for them, you know. But they talked about my mama, and I got mad about it. But that's the only time I got mad. And so we went off in the service, and I didn't make the money that I was making, but I was less stressed because I wasn't working as much until I was assigned to a duty station, and then I was working all the time again, and I felt like, well, I'm making less money for more work. And I've got 3 years to do, and ended up re-upping, so, well, I don't know what was wrong with me. But I re-upped, and one day, a Pentecostal moment happened. I was headed to the bar. Now, I may have told you this story, but I want you to understand the Pentecostal moment. This week we talked with some other pastors, and they were talking about speaking in tongues and how some churches don't speak in tongues, and some are totally against it. And if they'd known that the speaker that they got was a tongue speaker, they wouldn't have got them and all this kind of stuff. And so for y'all's service. I understand speaking in tongues, but I understand it a whole different way. Now, I know there is a spiritual language out there. But the Bible says that if you're going to speak in tongues, you must have an interpreter. And that it must be, you must have the interpreter there. So that means you got to line up your interpreter before you go speaking in tongues. At least the way I read it. Or if you get there and tongues start, there better be an interpreter. Right? Because only the Holy Spirit can do that. So I was in the army, and I was headed to the bar late one night. And I was going to go, they had nickel slot machines there. And I was going to go play the nickel slots. And the Lord told me, go to the chapel. Now this is at midnight. And the Lord tells me to go to the chapel. Now, the chapel is a cross post. It's going to take a minute to get there. Probably like 15-minute walk. And I'm thinking, I'm right here at the bar. That's where I'm headed. Why do you want me to go to the chapel? And he's like, go to the chapel. I'm like, Lord, it's midnight. If somebody's at the chapel, they shouldn't be. He's like, go to the chapel. So I argued with him for, a few more steps, and I'm like, all right, I'll go to the chapel. So I start walking my 15-minute walk across the post. I have to go through all these dark alleys. I have to go through a dark spot beside a pond. I'm in Germany in the dark, okay? I'm not happy about it. I'm headed to the chapel. And as I get closer to the chapel, I get around the pond. There's the chapel, and the lights are on. And I'm thinking, oh my goodness, something's going on at the chapel. So I go around, I finally get up to the chapel, I step in, there's a priest up at the front, and he's speaking in Spanish, and all these people are in there in this Spanish service. I don't speak a Spanish. No habla, señor. And I barely understand Spanish. So I step in, I get on the back row. There's my sergeant standing right beside me. And I'm like, what are you doing here? And he looks at me and he's like, what you doing here? And he's Puerto Rican. And so he's like, hey man, what you doing here? And I'm like, Sergeant, what are you doing here? This is a Puerto Rican mass service. I'm like, okay. Lord told me to come. Oh, good, wow. Great. And so we start having church. And so they get to the preaching part, and this priest is speaking in Spanish, and I sure can't follow him. But all of a sudden, the Lord starts talking to me through this priest in English. And I start understanding everything this priest is saying directly to me. And at that time, my sergeant leans over and says, you need me to translate for you? And I'm like, no, Sergeant, I got it. I understand everything he's saying. And he was saying, why are you running from me? Why do you keep running from me? And when are you going to stop? And I'm like, I hear you, Lord. Because only you could speak to me through that hand in the way that you're doing it. I'm getting chills thinking about it. It was a in the tongues moment. It's exactly what I see happening with Peter and the disciples as the Spirit comes upon them, so much so that other people thought, they must be drunk. because there was people understanding what they were saying, interpreting what they were saying. Amazing. Now there's also a Holy Spirit language. There's a spirit with a language where the Spirit speaks on your behalf to God. That happens. That's also happened to me in my lifetime when I was struggling with drugs. I heard the Holy Spirit pray for me. So I know that happens too. But I do not have the gift of tongues and therefore cannot be assembly of God. You know, you have to get the gift in order to be there, right? That's what some of them believe. Some of the Pentecostal movements believe that. But did you know that the holiness movement came out of the Methodist Church? It's our fault. We weren't teaching. You know, so they just start rolling down the aisle. We'll show y'all, you know. You sit there reserved, we'll show you how to worship. You know, that's great. So anytime I say Pentecost from here on out, just raise your hand and go like that. Do a jazz hand, okay? Pentecost. Woo, yeah. You know, the Lord loves to speak to us. Do you know that? But we have to be still and listen. And therein lies the problem. We are so busy. I heard a teacher this week say that she only allows her son to be on his media products, whether that's video games or whatever, 3 hours a day. Now, while I think 3 hours a day is probably too much, I'm glad it's only 3 hours a day. How many of y'all grew up jumping creeks? Swinging on vines in East Texas. Woo! Finding muscadines growing out in the woods. Uh-huh. Wasn't it fun? Wasn't it fun coming home, being worried that you were so muddy and mama was going to beat you from one end to the other? Wasn't it fun? Or you had to, my deal was I always wore my Sunday shoes because we would go see family and I never took extra clothes. So I always had my Sunday shoes on when we would go play in the ponds and stuff. And I always got in trouble because I'd get mud all over my suit pants and my shoes. You know? But it was so much fun. It was almost worth the spanking. You know, church was fun back in those days. You know, you came to church and everybody was happy to see you and everybody loved on you. And you felt rest in the Lord. And the Lord spoke to us. And when we got up, we went to see our family and we talked about the sermon. How bad the preacher was. You know, can you believe his wife dresses like that? That's the preacher's wife. You know, I know y'all say y'all thinking of one right now. Yeah, I remember one. Yeah. Those days were fun. Why? Because the Holy Spirit was living in between us and into us and around us. And everybody respected the Lord. Remember those days when you went to a restaurant after church and it was weird when you saw somebody not pray before they started eating? We need to get back to that, folks. We need to get back to that. But today I'm going to talk to you about rest. Summertime for teachers, students, and many other folks offers us a time to find rest from our suffering of the day-to-day grind of moving our economy forward in our workforce of our nation and world. Do you realize that when you work, you're not just working for yourself? You're working for the national economy. Everything you do supports our economy. Everything we don't do does what? Hurts our economy, right? And I've caught about that much news, and I know that they're talking about the debt ceiling, right? Guess who pays the debt ceiling? We do. Not the people that are deciding it. We do. We, the people. You know? So yeah, we need to work. What do we need to work for? Our family, our homes, our communities, our towns, our, eventually our nation, right? And for our church, of course. Right? We're God's people. Heard this morning about people in other countries being killed and put into American vehicles because of the salvation of Jesus Christ. And that they're singing as they go to be killed. We have it so good here. All we worry about is the debt ceiling. You know? It'd help if we just paid our bills. Right? See, the government's living like a lot of Americans are living. They're living up there taking the check and not paying the bill. Taking the pay but not paying the bill. And that's an issue, folks. That's an issue. But how do we find rest? God's power is immeasurable to give you rest. It is immeasurable. It is there for you to have. The Holy Spirit will give you rest through God's power. Look at the scripture, Ephesians 1, 17 through 21. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation. You know, when the Spirit fell on those people at Pentecost, don't you know that they had wisdom and revelation? It says so because what did they do? How did they live afterwards?
By the Word of God.
Okay, what else? All right, they took the Word of God, they spread the Word of God, but what else? How did they live together? With everything in common. Don't you think that was wisdom and revelation? Don't you think? Now, they went and sold land because somebody in the church was in need. We've seen that here. The greatest story y'all tell is about the lady that built the kitchen by selling bread. I love that story. For me, it's a story because I wasn't here. For you, it's a memory and a real life event where somebody in your church said, I will do everything that I can so that we can share in common a kitchen that will serve this community. You don't think the Holy Spirit was behind that? You don't think the Holy Spirit kept people hungry for bread? You don't think the Holy Spirit was the driving force behind her, the immeasurable power? May give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know Him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which He has called you. God calls you to hope. You know, yes, we're facing a lot of issues in our government. And if you watch the media, you can lose all hope. I would say take a rest from media. Take a summertime vacation from media. Go watch a good wholesome movie if you can find one. Get PureFlix instead of Netflix. If you don't know that, go look it up. Pure flesh. It's Christian based. You should pay them instead of somebody else. You can have somebody else too, but get on pure flesh. God's trying to give us the word to which he has called you. The riches of his glory, his inheritance in his holy people. And his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as mighty strength. He exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand of the heavenly realms. If he can do that, what can he do for you? If he can raise Jesus from the dead, if he can ascend him into the air, take him into heaven, set him at the right hand, and say, Son, get out. What can he do for you? Far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the age to come. Are we living in that power? Are we resting? Are we resting in that power, or are we fighting? Fighting. Fighting. If I just get one more thing done, I'll be where I need to be. What about if God will just take care of this for me with his mighty power, I will be where he wants me to be. We mostly think of the fallen state of man when we think of restoration. When we think, what do we need to be restored from when we have sin? Hosea 6:1, come, let us return to the Lord. He has torn us to pieces, but, you know, you think about our country. It looks like it's torn to pieces, doesn't it? What tore us to pieces? We did it ourselves. Sin. But what did it? Worse than that. Worse than selfishness. Worse than greed. What's the worst thing we did back in, let's see, 85, 84, 83, 82, 81, 80, 79, 78, 77, 76, 75, 1973 or 4, we took God out of schools. It's our biggest mistake this country ever made. We made plenty of other mistakes. But the day that we said we don't need God anymore as a country was the day that we signed our doom of declaration, or declaration of doom. Every Christian since then has said we need prayer back in school. Are we listened to?
No.
They'd rather serve the 18% of our country than the 85 to 90%. I know the math don't add up there for those math teachers. You get my point. He has torn us to pieces. But he will heal us. He has injured us, but he will bind up our wounds. If we wait upon the Lord. Right? He said so. You know, I think sometimes we are our own worst enemies, and we become stumbling blocks for our family, we become stumbling blocks for our friends. We become stumbling blocks to those that are watching us One thing I did not agree with, and I'm going to tell you, so you were there, Jack, is the first point that he made with don't live for others' approval. I don't agree with that. Because the Bible tells us to be approved before man and before God. Okay? So I didn't agree with that statement. I understood what he was getting at. Don't be looking for the approval of social media. And I agree with that part of it. But we live by our reputation. Folks, your reputation is everything. Amen. It's the only thing you have. When you walk up and shake a man's hand, that means something. It means something. If I walk up and say, I'm going to do such and such, then you may have to call me and remind me. I don't know if it's a COVID shot or what, but I forget a lot. But if I give you my word, I'm going to do it. I stayed in that classroom up there because I told them I would help until the end of the year. The boss lady come in at the end of the year, I've seen her twice since I've been there, came in at the last day of the school, and she's like, are you going to help us again next year? I said, no. What I said I was going to do, I did. You know? I'm done. Why? You got an asylum up here, and I'm not being a part of it. You know? That's the truth of it. However, I did say, I'll sub from time to time if you need me. Not like we did just now. Right? Why? Because I still want to be a part. I still want to try to make a difference. But there's no way I can handle going back like I did. You know? I'd rather deal with the worst of catastrophes and the aftermath of that than have to go day after day to this school and do what I did for since January. Now that's saying something. And your teachers are there every day fighting that, trying to make a difference. They need rest. As a matter of fact, I challenge this church, if you know a teacher, do several nice things for them this summer. Make them supper, whatever. Pretend like they had somebody die in their family and take them to dinner. They need it. They deserve it. You say, well, they get off 2 months. You know how many in services they have to go to through the summer and get all their stuff ready for the next year so that they're legal with the state and all these kind of things, then try to do for the church and try to do for the community and try to do for their husbands, try to do for their wives. Folks, they need our help. They're raising our next generation, and we better take care of it. Because they're not being raised at home. Romans 14:13 says, therefore, let us not judge one another anymore, but rather determine this, not to put an obstacle or a stumbling block in a brother or sister's way. In other words, quit judging them and just make sure you don't put a stumbling block in their way. Make sure you're a good example. Make sure you're teaching them. Make sure you're gently bringing them to the Lord, that every time you see them, you invite them to church. Every time you see them, you invite them to be a part of what's going on in our community. Every time you see somebody, make them be a part. Make them feel wanted. Don't be a stumbling block. The great thing we can do is to find hope in God's power and restoration. Isaiah 40:31, but those whose hope is in the Lord will what? Renew their strength. They will soar with wings like eagles. They will run, not grow weary. They will walk, and not be faint. You know? When your strength's in the Lord, everything works out. His hope comes to us. through his word. Romans 15:4, for everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in Scripture and encouragement they provide, we may have hope. Scripture brings you hope. If you're not in the Scripture, you're not going to have the hope that you need to survive this world. Psalm says, David says, created me a clean heart, O God, and renew the right spirit within me. Are you living with a clean heart? Is God's spirit the right spirit that's within you? Or are you too busy worrying about your family, or too busy getting mad at your family? Sometimes I get mad at my family, you know? Last night, I'll give you a little example. Melanie had to take Katie to buy a gift for her friend. Melanie says, do you want to go get it now? Katie says, yes, I want to go now. Melanie says, honey, would you like to go with us? I said, sure, I'd be glad to go. My daughter said, I don't want to go with him, I just want to go with you. Well, I got mad. I said, you're invited the whole time they were gone. You know? No, I don't want to go with him. Just forget it. You know? So we get mad at family. But where's our hope and our strength? Right here. There's hope for Katie. Every time I don't take her to the city gates and stone her, like the Bible says, there's hope for her. You know? There's hope for our children. There's hope. Someday that teenageness will turn off. And she'll like Obed again. Happened with Kate, I mean, happened with Natalie, happened with Disney. I'm good to go with two of them. They like to manage my life, but other than that, we're fine. You know, they tell me what I can't do. Oh, Daddy, you're too old for that. You can't do that. Who are you? You better start saving up money. I'm coming to live with you. You lived on me for 20 years. I'm coming to see you. Yeah. Ezekiel 36:25-27 says, I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanliness, and from all your idols I will cleanse you, and I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. Then we can say we have truly found rest and restoration, which leaves us in peace and full of God's joy. Folks, you're about to go to summer. I want you to enjoy it. I don't want you to miss church. You don't have to. But I want you to enjoy it. I want you to find the rest that you need. But folks, you're not going to find the rest that you need if you don't take God with you. So first and foremost, study his word. Take him with you. Let his rest be the rest that offers you restoration through repentance, which is the key. Gives you hope through his word, which is the key. And gives you the power to be his people. Make a difference for your family, for others, and yourself. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us stand and sing, let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. If you need to make any decision on your behalf of the Lord today, I invite you to do so. If you need to join this church, we'd love to have you. You come as we sing, let there be peace on earth.
remember. May you be blessed today. May this day bless others as God shines through you. In Christ's holy name.